Okay, so our Parsha, Parshat Ki Teitzay, is filled with mitzvot. So I'd like to first of all work a little bit on one aspect that touches upon what we discussed last week. And then I want to double back to this concept of mitzvot, something that we mentioned last year, but build on that with how it dovetails with Amalek in a pretty amazing way. Let's go to page 1061. Dov, I know you said it for the beginning, but we're taking a little bit of a jump.
1068?
Mm-hmm.
8?
No, 1060? And 1061, Hebrew and English.
Bizarro world.
Okay. Let's take verses 8 and 9. Okay. Be'ivrit miri v'vakasha.
Yishamer benega hatzara'at, yishmor me'od, v'lasok kukol asher yoru otchem hakohanim, הלוויים כאשר ציוויתם תשמרו לעשות. זכור את אשר עשה אדוני אלוהיך למרים בדרך בצאתכם ממצרים.
Good. In English, באנגלית? So in English, Chaya?
Chava,
I'm sorry.
You will be aware of Sarah's affliction, be very careful, and to act according to everything that the Kohanim, the Levites, shall teach you, as I have commanded them. You shall be careful to perform. Remember what Hashem your God did to Miriam on the way when you were leaving Egypt.
Good. So we have an obligation to remember what Hashem did to Miriam. There's a famous story that Chavos Chaim tells a story. He gives a mashal, he gives a parable of a person, right? Of a person who, very often, right? Very often, you know, we read what we're supposed to read, right? The Chavos Chaim tells a story of a person who was a wealthy person, a lot of servants in the house. And he was going away for a week. And he gave them a whole long list of things that he wanted them to do. And he said to them, make sure you see that list. Make sure you read that list. Right? A whole long list of things that need to be done. Right? He comes back a week later. Nothing's done.
Because he didn't
give him his instructions. Any of us with children? Right? Absolutely nothing is done. Right? So he says to them, I understand. I gave you the list. I said, yes, of course. I said, I told you to read the list. And they said, yes, we did. We read the list. Right? So you could read the list, right? But you don't necessarily take care of what is on the list, right? The Chavos Chaim says it in terms of the Shema. We have a mitzvah of Kriyat Shema. Right, the mitzvah of reading the Shema. But it's not simply to read the Shema, it's to be ahavta at Hashem Elokecha, to love Hashem your God v'chol levavecha v'chol nafshecha v'chol modech, with all of your heart and all of your soul and all of your belongings or in every midah, in every situation. So the commandment is not simply to read the Shema, it is to do the Shema. Similarly, the Chavetz Chaim says over here, Zechor, we have a commandment. Zechor, to remember, 1060.
But Rabbi, it's easier, you can, if you give you a list to do things, but to make you feel, it's important.
Okay, granted, you're making a good point, and the question is brought up, how can there be a commandment of feelings, of love, right? That's a good question. And there are different solutions to that, right? Right.
I know it, what you'll say. Start doing it, and you'll start feeling.
Well, on one hand, yes, right. Also, if a person thinks for a moment or more than a moment, and really, really, really gives thought to all the good that we have. Right, all the free good that we have. I can forget about bigger things. I can see I can walk. I'm alive. All of these matnot chinam, all of these free gifts. It's right. Okay, so let's come over here. The pasuk says zachor, right? Be careful with tzara'at, with this. Again, I don't want to call it leprosy. It's not leprosy. It's tzara'at. It was this spiritual affliction that came upon those for speaking lashon hara, speaking disparagingly about others. And then it says, remember et asher asa Hashem Elokecha lemiriam biderech bitseitchem mimitzrayim. Remember that which Hashem your God did to Miriam on the road bitseitchem mimitzrayim, as you were leaving Egypt. So I think Chavetz Chaim says over here that in order for us, and of course, what happened with Miriam? Miriam spoke
about Moshe.
Right?
Marriage.
Right? Good. So remembering this is supposed to shake us up. And when we're about to say something, did you hear about so-and-so? Thinking about this is meant to shake us up. But there are four components that are listed over here. What are the four components? Et asher asa Hashem Elokecha lemiriam baderech bitseitchem mimitzrayim. So it's what Hashem, your God, that's one, did to Miriam, that's two, where, biderech, on the road, when, bitseitchem mimitzrayim, as you're leaving Egypt. So what are lessons that we can learn from these four points that the pasuk is emphasizing? Remember that which Hashem Elokecha, Hashem your God. What might be the emphasis, the lesson of it being particularly Hashem your God?
He sets the standards from which we need to govern our lives.
Okay, God sets the standards that we govern our lives. Good. And what is unique? What is unique about Lashon Hara and Tzara'at? What is unique amongst all of the commandments of the Torah? This is absolutely unique. There's 612 on one side, and this one on the other side.
There's an immediate reaction.
Good. Yeah. The proverbial thunderbolt. Right? Right? You know, we always say, what, is lightning going to strike me? Yeah. Right? And that's true. By 612, that's true. Lightning is not going to strike. There's not going to be this proverbial thunderbolt, immediate reaction, clear reaction. When it comes to Lashon Hara, there is, at least there was when we were on that level, this immediate reaction. If that's the case, that Hashem Elokecha is the one who, kaboom, because of this, that is reason to give pause, if I'm about to speak. Lemiriam. Lemiriam, to Miriam. What is supposed to shake us up?
She was a great tzaddiket.
Okay, Miriam was a great tzaddiket. Right? Let's go further with Miriam. Who did she speak about?
Her brother Moshe.
Now, did she have any history with her brother Moshe?
Yes. Yes.
Like saving his life?
Oh, yeah.
Right. 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 You know, putting her life in danger, standing there to see what was going to happen. Right? And everyone else has given up. She's over there waiting to see what will happen. And then seeing the daughter of Paro, right? Hitler's daughter is the one who picks up Moshe. the daughter of the one who made the decree about every boy being killed, his daughter picked her up. His daughter picked him up, sorry. And then approaching and saying, right, and seeing that she's being compassionate and seeing that Moshe's not nursing from the Egyptian woman, can I bring a wet nurse from the Hebrews? Right? She had incredible courage, and was willing to put her life in danger for Moshe. Don't forget, she's the one who had the prophecy about Moshe's birth. That's why she's called Miriam HaNeviah, Achot Aaron, the sister of Aaron. She was the sister of Aaron when she had that prophecy. So it's Miriam, a great tzaddiket, speaking about Moshe, the brother that she, whose life she helped save, who she adored and revered, I'm sorry?
At the risk of her own life.
At the risk of her own life. Now, how insulted do you think Moshe is going to get?
He isn't.
Right? Moshe, we say, is Anav Mikol Adam. Moshe was the most humble of all people. Right? And what does she say about him?
She talks about his wife.
Yeah, according to the Medrash, what does she say? She was complaining that Moshe was no longer, Moshe had separated from his wife after Matan Torah.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, now who did she go to the National Enquirer and spill the story?
No.
Who did she go to?
Aaron,
his brother. If there's anyone who can remedy what she saw as a mistake on Moshe's part, who can remedy it? Aaron. She went to him quietly, privately, and she shared it with him. Was her intentions to disparage Moshe?
No.
Or to remedy the situation? To remedy. So the whole mistake was in shikul hadat. It was a mistake in judgment. She should have understood that Moshe was in a different category.
She had good intentions.
She had good intentions. And she went to the right person. And she did it in a discreet manner. And she did it out of love for a person that she revered.
For a sister-in-law.
Imagine, could have been her mother-in-law. But for a sister-in-law, that would be too much. For a sister-in-law.
But for this you need the midrash, because the pshat, she really said, he married a black woman. I mean, we try to cover it and cover it and cover it because she is beautiful.
One second. So I'll odot about the Isha HaKushita Shelakach, right? Right? But, okay, so yes. But first of all, let's understand the Medrash is Torah Sheba'al Peh. Right? Torah Sheba'al Peh means it's the oral Torah that was taught to Moshe on Sinai and passed down to us in the Talmud, in the Midrash.
But the Pshat,
right?
Also. It's
the Pshat also. But even in the Pshat. So what does God say back to them? Right? You're not like Moshe. Right? Moshe, right? I speak to him mouth to mouth, right? You know, face to face, right? So if it's simply, if we go according to the Pshat, it's also not simple. If it's a black woman, then what's the issue of I speak to him face to face? Right? Clearly God's response is, you don't understand the Nevuah level of Moshe. Okay? So, right? I'm sorry?
That was the issue. It wasn't a skin issue.
Yes.
People mixed races then anyway.
Correct.
It was
correct.
Very common.
So, remember what Hashem Elokecha, thunderbolt, did to who? To Miriam. With all of these mitigating factors, but nevertheless, she made the wrong call. And she did speak to Aaron when she shouldn't have. And there were such repercussions. But what were the repercussions, by the way?
Saras.
She had this saras. And what did everyone need to do?
Wait.
Had to wait 7 days. And when did God do it? Baderech.
On the way.
On the way, meaning what? What's the emphasis of on the way?
They're not going to get to where they're going.
They're not going to get to where they need to get to.
The Egyptians are on the...
Okay. And it's going to publicize it. Right? Had they gotten to their place, this happens. So Miriam discreetly goes outside the kamachana, outside the camp, and then she comes back into the camp. And
the purpose was to teach us all on okay. her example. That's
okay.
It.
It happened baderech, on the way, right? When it became known to everyone, because why aren't we traveling yet? Right? You know, you're trying to go on a family trip, you know. Oh, so-and-so's still packing, right? Why aren't we traveling yet? Oh, Miriam. Miriam spoke, and therefore she's outside the machane. We have to wait for Miriam. How long are we waiting? 7 days.
But the people willingly waited for
yes, it. But yes, it's certainly but Baderech certainly publicized the whole matter. Bitzeitchem mi Mitzrayim. Fourth, lastly, as you were leaving Egypt. What might be the emphasis of as you were leaving Egypt?
You were leaving a culture, the bad thing, the different thing. You were trying to be Jews.
Okay, moving on our way. Good. Dad, you want to say?
Leaving that world, leaving the outer world and building your own new world.
Good. So it's so important to get to where we need to get to. And nevertheless, look. So the Chavetz Chaim, I believe it's Chavetz Chaim says, I'm sure it's the Chavetz Chaim, right? Says that the pasuk is not simply saying, oh, remember Miriam, or just say this pasuk, but to think about these four points that the pasuk is emphasizing. And if we're, you know, should I say it? Should I not say it? Is it Lashon Hara? Is it, I really want to say it, but that's really, I shouldn't say it. Or maybe, then we start to justify, maybe it's not Lashon Hara. Maybe it's really okay. Zechor, remember. What Hashem Elokecha did to Miriam, Bad Derech, on the road as you were leaving Egypt. Right.
Was this after Matan Torah or before? When what? This I mean, was, in that timeline, when did it actually happen?
I believe this was before.
Before what?
No. It has to be afterwards. It has to be afterwards. I'm sorry. Oh. It's 100% afterwards, right? Because the whole idea is that the way it's explained is that according to the Medrash, Dalia, so Hashem said back to them, right, after Har Sinai, the Pasuk said, Shuvu lachem la'alechem. You all return to your tents, v'ata po amod imadi. And you, Moshe, stand here with me. From there we learned out that everyone else was supposed to, everyone had separated, husband and wife had separated before Matan Torah, 3 days before Matan Torah. Right after the giving of the Torah, after the Ten Commandments, right, the Har Sinai, they were told to go back to their tents, meaning to return back to normal family life. Vata po amodi madi, but you, Moshe, stand here with me. Right, and that was the indication from above. Right, the Gemara says the three things that Moshe did on his own, and in fact he understood it correctly, and one of them is Piresh Min Aisha, they separated from his wife, based on that pasuk. So it was after Matan Torah.
So they're not scared of the Egyptians coming after them, because they've already seen
correct.
The Egyptians.
Right, it's not an issue of the Egyptians, it's an issue of on our way to our destiny and delaying that.
Does anybody talk about how or if she had spoken to Moshe directly, none of this would have occurred?
Okay, I think Shirley's making an excellent point, and that might be part and parcel of the shikul hadat, of the judgment issue, right? She had a concern, which in her mind was a valid concern, right? And perhaps she should have approached Moshe directly.
Because she actually broadened the entire thing by not directing it to the person who she was concerned.
You know, she broadened it as minimally as possible by going to Aaron, period. But even that seems to have been right. I think you are correct on that, right? That was the issue. Of instead of going to the person. Very often when we do go to the person, then we understand we get a whole different take on what actually happened or is happening. Dove.
So Hashem, the most merciful, your God, who does only good, is doing good for her, it's also good for all of you.
It's a lesson for all of us, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So you're saying, you're saying that these 4 points apply to us today.
Well,
when we should speak, who we should speak to, how we should consider it, kind of thing. That's
could
what
be.
I'm saying.
Could be. What I was saying is, if we look back at the event that happened with Miriam, and we really look into these four aspects that the pasuk is emphasizing by Miriam, that will shake us up about today, and certainly some of them will apply to us today, right?
You know, should we speak it in public?
Right.
Like on the way. On the way implies we're not alone.
Okay.
There are others around us.
Okay.
Right? That kind of thing. There's a few other things which imply what could be done, what we could do today, and how we can see our Lashon Hara today.
Yeah.
Is what I'm
saying. And to hold ourselves in check. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Those that can certainly should be. Yeah.
I think it also shows that even though you think you're telling one person, the effect of Lashon Hara affects more than one person. Because at the end of the day, I mean, even if you're trying from a good point of view, even trying to make a surprise party, and you say, don't tell anyone, absolutely no one, and somehow or another, the person who surprised it is, they know, because one person said one little wrong thing. And that's when you're trying out of a good way. I mean, not Lashon Hara, but I mean, that's story.
Yeah.
And so it does impact.
I've said before, I always marvel, right? You got something that you don't want people to know, right? So you go to one person and you say, don't tell anyone else, but, right? Which means, right?
Everybody.
You, who have a vested interest in it not spreading, right? Weren't able to hold it in to yourself. Right? So, and you think that this person who has no vested interest in it not spreading, right,
is
not going to spread it, right? Chances are that's not what's going to happen. Okay, let's go to a completely different issue now, which, yes?
I don't know, not on the topic, but it has to do with Miriam. And before you move to the next topic, I really wanted to share this with you.
Sure.
This past summer, the organization that I work for produced a film. It was called Daring to Rescue. It was about those people who had the courage, no matter what, to rescue people in the Holocaust at the risk of their own lives. Rabbi Yisroel Meir Lau was the guest speaker at our premiere. He came in from Eretz Yisrael, especially to speak.
What's the organization, Nami?
It's called Project Witness.
Oh, Project Witness, good.
And he spoke. And at the end of the speech, before he introduced the film, he said the following, and it was something, you were speaking about Miriam, and you mentioned Miriam's background, and I couldn't resist interrupting, and I'm sorry about that.
No, only an addition, not an interruption.
Okay, thank you. And what he said was as follows. Let me ask you something, he said. When was the first Holocaust? Who was the first rescuer? Who was the first among the non-Jews who was righteous? So, you know, we weren't thinking, Miriam, we weren't thinking anything like that. You kind of wonder, what was the first Holocaust that Jews experienced? He said, when Paro insisted that all the boys be destroyed, this was a Holocaust. Holocaust. This was the first Holocaust. Who was the righteous non-Jew who extended the hand?
Pharaoh's daughter.
Batya. Who was the one who dared to rescue? It was Miriam. And that's how he introduced this film, which was called Daring to Rescue.
Wow.
And to me, that was such a new perspective.
Mm-hmm.
I had never thought of it that way. Never thought of that was the first Holocaust. Here was the first righteous among the non-Jews who chose to rescue him. And here was the first rescuer. Right in front of our eyes.
Very nice.
And I just thought you were mentioning
beautiful.
Miriam and the background.
Beautiful.
I couldn't resist it.
Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful.
Beautiful.
Okay. Our Parsha, if we'll just glance, 10:47, we're going to just glance at the list of mitzvot that we have over here. And by doing that, we're just going to glance at the little caption, right? The woman of beautiful form, that's all the laws of going out to battle, right? When one can and cannot take a woman. The firstborn's inviolable right. See what I'm doing, everybody? I'm reading the little captions, right? That is the laws of inheritance. Okay, 1049, the wayward and rebellious son, right? Hanging and burial. Concern for the property of another. 1051, male and female garb. Saying the mother bird from the nest. Protective fence. Tzitzit. 1053, defamation of a married woman. The accusation was true. Adultery. A betrothed maiden. 55, forbidden restricted marriages. Sanctity of the camp. An escaped slave. Sexual purity. Interest. We discussed that yesterday, an interesting case between Mincha and Marv. We discussed the case of a person who lent money to a shul to build a new shul with the provision that they named the shul after his father. How that too was considered interest, because normally if you want to have a shul named, you have to give a donation. You can't just lend money. So he lent money, got it back, and got a name of a shul after his late father. Right? That's how pervasive interest could be. Vows to God, a worker's right to eat, divorce, remarriage, millstone. Right? Millstone is taking something as collateral, right? Don't take something that the person needs for their subsistence, right? As collateral. Kidnapping, sarat and slander, we just saw, dignity of a debtor. If you're going in to collect collateral, right? You can't go into his house and seize collateral. He's got to bring something out. Timely payment of workers, individual responsibility, consideration for the orphan and widow, gifts to the poor from the harvest, lashes, how that's done when it happens, levirate marriage and releasing the obligation, that's what we call yibum, penalty for embarrassing another, honest weights and measures, remembering Amalek. So we have this whole host of mitzvot. And just stay on 1066, 1067. We have this whole host of mitzvot, and then we have Amalek. So in the Sefer Mimam Akim, he goes through in such a beautiful way, what are mitzvot, and what is the view of an Amalek?
Again?
And he says as follows. The famous pasuk in Mishlei, Ciner mitzvah v'Torah or. Torah is called light. Mitzvah is a candle. Meaning.
My phone keeps coming. I shut it off and keeps going.
You're a popular person, Chaim.
No, I'm not popular. I made a big boo boo here. I don't understand what I'm doing.
Yeah, me too.
I should. Easy to say. I did it already.
We need a teenager here.
I already said
to figure out how to do this thing.
We need a 3 to 5 years old. They know how to do it.
Yeah. Power off. See? And just phone shut off.
It's some nice background music. It's fine.
Why not?
Ner mitzvah, v'Torah or. Okay? So, you have a light. What does the ner, what does the candle do? It gives the physical entity upon which that light can take effect and can be carried. Torah is light, but how do we bring that light to us? How do we connect to that light? What is the physical means through which we connect to this light of Torah? Torah meaning instructions, teachings of God. How do we connect to that light, to that which is non-physical, through the mitzvot? And it's fascinating. And very often other religions say, oh, Jews, they're so into all of this, the milk and the meat and right, all of these, all of this doing instead of this floating away and delving into other worlds. Yes. We say the way to breathe, to bring holiness down, is through by taking the physical and sanctifying it. For us, the holiest level is Kedusha. Kedusha is the physical becoming sanctified. And he says a beautiful thing. I don't know if the Israelites will will all agree with this is the terminology in the Torah, right? Probably not in modern Hebrew. Mitzvah, right, are commandments, right? So what is mitzvah? It's a strange conjugation of the word, right? Call it tzivuyin, right? Commands. Mitzvah is a strange conjugation. So he says as follows. When you have a lender and a borrower, you have the malve, that's the lender. You have the love, the borrower. At what point do the two come together? By the milve. That is the Torah term for the loan. That's the milve. Similarly, we have a mitzaveh, that's the one who commands. We have the mitzuveh, those are the ones who are being commanded. Where do they meet? At the mitzvah.
That's nice.
That's the term, the mitzvah. So the mitzvah is that flashpoint, is the meeting point between the connection between the mitzaveh and the mitzuveh. So it's not simply tzivuyim, commands. That's not the idea. Commands is you do this, you do that, you do this, you do that. The point is the meeting, is the coming together. That's the ner mitzvah v'torah or. The ner is the mitzvah. The mitzvah is the candle, is the physical container which allows that or, that light, to come in contact and to permeate. That is the idea of the mitzvah. And that's why the Chazal, the sages say, mitzvah is also is a term of tzaveta, of accompaniment. Tzevet, right? That's where we join. That's where we have that accompaniment. And the idea of a mitzvah is accompanying. Right? The idea of a mitzvah is taking that spirituality and bringing it down into this world. Right? We say in Hallel, Hamagbili Lashem Mikashem Elokeini. Mikashem Elokeini Hamagbili Hamashpili Lerot Bashamayim Uva Aretz. I forget the exact psukim. Right. But by the nation of the world, they say God is in the Shamayim. Right? That's their view. Right? God is in the Shamayim without a connection to what goes on down. Right? Who's like Hashem Elokeinu? Right? Who comes down, right? I'm getting it wrong, but it comes down into the earth. Right? And I mentioned last year also, this is actually indicated in the word mitzvah. Okay? Let's hear how we see this in the word mitzvah. Okay. There are a lot of places where we find Hashem's name hidden in there. Classic example, the Gemara says, an ish and an isha, a man and a woman. Right? The Gemara says, if there's peace between them, then Hashem is with them. If there's no peace, then they're consumed by fire. We see that in the words. How is that? Ish is Aleph Yud Shin. That's Eish, fire, with the letter Yud. Isha, Aleph Shin Hey. Eish, with the letter Hey. Okay? So therefore, if there's peace amongst them, Hashem is there, Yud is there, Hey is there, Hashem is there. We have an Ish and an Isha. If there's no peace with them, Hashem says, I'm out of here. What are we left with? Take out the Yud, what do we take out the Hay, what are we left with? Eish and Eish. They're consumed by fire. Eish is fire, right? And interestingly, by Eish you have Aleph, Yud, Shin. The letter of God's name separates the Aleph and the Shin of the fire, right? A man is a little, often, usually is a little more, has a greater tendency towards anger, towards flying off the handle. So he needs the letter of Hashem's name right in the middle. Isha, Eish, Hey. The letter Hashem's name could be afterwards, right? Less of an issue. Now, when they get married, they need to have a ketubah, right? The ketubah is the Jewish marriage document. Ketubah is chaf, tuf, vav, vet, hey. Now, the shorish, the three-letter root for the word ketubah is katav, means to write. What other letters are there in the word ketubah besides the shorish? Vav and hey. So an ish and an isha with a ketubah have yud, hey, followed by a vav, followed by a hey. They have Hashem's full name. Let's look at the word mitzvah. Mem, tzadi, vav, hey. So vav, hey jumps out at us. Vav, hey, the last two letters are the last letters of Hashem's name, the yud kei vav kei. Right? There's something called atbash. Atbash is a reflection. Aleph, the first letter, that's reflected by Tav, the last letter. Bet, the second letter, that's a reflection of Shin, right? And so on and so on. So let's look at Mem. Mem, Nun, Samach, Ayin, Pei, Tzadi, Kuf, Rei, Shin, Tav. Mem is the 10th letter from the end. What's that a reflection of? The 10th letter from the beginning, which of course is Yud. Second letter, Tzadi. Tzadi, Kuf, Rei, Shin, Tav. Tzadi is the 5th letter from the end. What's that a reflection of? The 5th letter from the beginning. Hey. So a mitzvah is a reflection from Shamayim coming down and us stepping up, and that's the meeting. That's what a mitzvah is. So a mitzvah and Torah at its essence is heaven coming down to earth. That is what it is all about. Right? Not that Hashem is up in the heavens, bringing God down, making this world an earthly world. That is what it is all about. Let's take a look at Amalek. Okay, 1066. It's contagious. You see, Chai Rivka, it's not just yours. It's contagious. Okay.
Can you
just say the words about the loan and melave? Those words.
Yes.
Again?
Yes. So a malve is the lender.
A malve.
A love is the borrower. The milve is the loan. The loan is where the lender and borrower
come together. Yes.
Mitzave is commander. Mitzuve is commandee, those who are being commanded. The mitzvah is that meeting point of the mitzave and the mitzuve. Right? So it is bringing the spirituality down here. Yes?
So is that also, I mean, the obvious thing of why the Beit HaMikdash is so important, is that's where...
Yes, yes. Again, beautiful point. Kedusha is the, right, we make, right, marriage is Kiddushin. The root of that is Kadosh, holiness. What does that mean? Right, Judaism, right, other religions might look at a physical relationship between a husband and a wife as being something that is lowly, that's for the weak, that's for those who can't transcend that. On the contrary, we say that is Kedusha. That's the physical world, physical life, physical being, physical relationship being made holy. Right? Kiddush, we sanctify the Shabbat. We take a day and we sanctify that Shabbat, right? The Beit HaMikdash, that is the place of the true Kedusha. And the sacrifices are the Kodesh Kadashim. And there are those that say, sacrifice, it seems so bloody and gory. The idea of the sacrifice is that it's the blood, it is the physicality that is meant to become sanctified. It's not, oh, you know, off on a mountaintop, right? You know, meditating. It's getting involved in this world. It's the blood. It's the meat. It's the innards. It's the kishkas, right? That's what we need to infuse with this kedusha, with this holiness. I don't want to go too far off. Okay.
Will Hashem's presence be able to be everywhere?
I'm sorry.
Will Hashem's presence be able to be everywhere, not just in
Yisroel? Yes.
It's supposed to be that way now.
Yes.
I think it's not.
Too. Yes. Okay. Amalek. Let's go this way. Sorry. Amalek. According to the Medrash, Zachor et asher asa lecha Amalek b'derech. Remember what Amalek did to you on the derech, b'tzeitchem Mitzrayim, as you were leaving Egypt, asher karcha b'derech, that they happened upon you on the way, is the way it is translated. Rashi says, lashon mikre. Right? It's a lashon, it's a term that refers to mikre. What is mikre? Mikre is coincidence. It just so happened to happen. Right? The antithesis of the Torah and mitzvot that we've been discussing is coincidence. Lack of involvement. Not God not being down here in this world. Up there, not worrying what's happening with all these armies of ants that scurry around the world and think that they're important with all of our innovations. That is the mikre. That is the worldview of an Amalek. Vayizanev b'cha kol anachashalem. And they struck those of you who were hindmost, who were behind. When you were tired and weary. Vayizanev, Rashi brings a strange medrash. Rashi brings the medrash, makat zanav chotech milot v'zorek klape mala. Strange. They took the foreskin and they threw it up towards the heavens, saying, this is what you want.
I don't understand.
Neither do I. We need to understand.
No. Where did you come from?
I read the Rashi. Vayezanev, zanav is like a tail. It's the end. Right? So the Medrash understands that this is referring to the foreskin that was cut off by circumcision. And they threw it up and say, God, this is what you want. This is what you're interested in. Why would they focus on the mitzvah of Mila, of circumcision? Or what are the sages telling us when they said the focus here is on the mitzvah of circumcision, of Mila?
What does Amalek have to do with it? Or you just,
this is what Amalek did. Amalek would cut the foreskins and throw it up towards the heavens and say, God, this is what you're interested in?
Of their own people?
I don't know. They would take the foreskins of a circumcision and throw it up.
The
right?
Made is a connection between the Jews and God, and he said, "Velo yare Elohim," and there he was.
Okay, but which mitzvah? If you had to pick a mitzvah that best illustrates this coming together of the physical and the spiritual, circumcision is basically, right, as physical as we are, that is the physicality of mankind. The Brit Milah is this physicality and spirituality meeting. That's why it's not just Milah, it is Brit Milah. Milah means, I have your mind, don't worry. Okay. Milah is circumcision. Brit Milah is the covenant of circumcision. Right, that's why we don't just do it in a hospital. That's circumcision. It's not circumcision alone. It's the covenant of circumcision, meaning the physical and the spiritual meeting coming together. That is what Amalek was completely against. Their worldview was, maybe there's a God, let there be a God. But there's no godliness down here. Down here, what is it? It's all karcha. It's all mikra. It's all coincidence. It's all happenstance. It's all things that just happened.
It's,
the
pritmila is...
So they're not believing in Hashem.
Just one second, Chayrefka, what are you saying?
I'm saying the important part of the Brit Mila is that something unfinished becomes finished.
Yeah.
And then it's a connection.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
So if they don't believe in things happening on purpose, that there is a God, they're saying there is no God, right?
Everything not necessarily.
Well, they're not afraid of God.
Not necessarily, right? Right. It's also that God is not
involved.
That's the feeling I have.
Uh-huh. Now, take a look back for a minute on chapter... Just one second. Page 393. That's where Amalek came and attacked us. Right here saying, remember when they came to you on your way out from Egypt. Let's see on page 392. Page 393. Let's see what it says over there by the actual attack. The last pasuk there on page 392. Right? Oh, let's go 14 and 15. Right? Vayomer Hashem al Moshe. Hashem said to Moshe, Ketov zot zikaron v'sefer. Write this as a remembrance in the book. V'sim, and place it, recited by Bazne Yehoshua in the ears of Joshua. Ki machoim chezech Amalek. I will erase the memory of Amalek, mitachan Hashemayim, from beneath the heavens. Vayiven Moshe Mizbeach. Moshe built an altar. V'ikrashmo, and he called that altar Hashem Nisi. Vayomer, and he said, Ki yad al kes ka milchama l'Hashem ba'amalek midor dor. For the hand is on the throne of God, the war against Amalek is generation to generation. Now, what's strange in the Hebrew? Kes means seat, throne. It's written missing a letter. Which letter is it missing?
Aleph.
Right? Now, the throne evokes an idea of a king. A king is his rule and connection with the nation. God's throne is incomplete with Amalek. Why is the throne incomplete? Because that worldview, which is against the whole idea of Torah Mitzvah, pushes God up there and not down here. Al Kes Ka, God's name. How is God's name written? Yud-Heh, but without the Vav-Heh. What is the Yud-Heh without the Vav-Heh? What do we say? That's up in the heavens. The Mitzvah, we do the Vav-Heh, and we have the Yud-Heh that reflects and we meet. What is their view? Yad al kes ka. They place God where? Yudke. Up there. Not down here. Not involved in the world. Not that our actions bring him down and engage him and allow us to meet with him. That's the Yad al kes ka. That's why they have just the Yud Heh. It's not a complete name. You don't have the Vav Heh. You don't have the mitzvah coming and meeting. Now,
why was it Amalek's fault? I mean, those people's fault. They were not given a mind.
They came and attacked. Well, first of all, this is after Mitzrayim, after Kriyat Yamsuf. All the nations heard, we say in the Az Yashir, and they trembled. They came and fought. They fought people as we were traveling in the desert. We were coming near their lands. We were coming at them, at their land. No, we were traveling in the desert, right? and they came, right? Theirs was a fight not just against us, but against this whole notion of God. And nowadays, the eradication of Amalek means this eradication of our misbelief, the Amalek that's in us about the doubt of, is God just up there? Or is God also down here? Does God care about me? Does God care about what goes on? Judaism says a resounding yes. He cares deeply. And what we, I think, all struggle with is, does he really care? That is the Amalek. Two other points I want to make. The most powerful tefillah that we have, the most powerful prayer that we have, is when Kaddish is being said, and we answer, Yehe Shemei Rabbah Mevarach Li'olam Ul'olmei Omaya. Yehe Shemei, may your great name, Rabbah, your name, Rabbah, great, Mevarach, may it be blessed, right? May it extend Li'olam Ul'olmei Omaya to this world and to all the worlds, for all eternity. So again, in Mimama Kim, I think they brought from Rechaim Vital, Shemei, right, may God's name extend, be made great. Meaning what? It shouldn't be up there, it should come down to here. How do you spell the word Shemei, the Aramaic Shemei? Shin Mem Yud Hey. So what are we asking? That the shame, Yud Hey, should be extended, right? Meaning, Yad Al Kes Ka. Right, where do they put him? Up in the heavens, but not down here, not involved, not caring about us. So we say our most potent, our most powerful prayer is Yehi Shem Hashem, Yehi Shemei Rabbah. May the name of Yud-Kei, that God up in the heavens, Mevarach, let it extend, let it be blessed. Blessed is growing, is going further. Let it extend, La'olam, Ulomei Amaya. Let us realize that God is involved in our everyday life. And yes, what we do matters profoundly and deeply to him. One last thing that we say all the time. V'ne'emar v'haya Hashem, as it stated, v'haya Hashem, and God will be l'melech al kol ha'aretz, the king, where? Over all the land. Bayom Hahu, on that day, Bayom Hahu, Yeh Hashem Echad, Ushmo Echad. God will be one, his name will be one. We'll have that complete understanding of that full involvement, of that full integration. Bayom Hahu, on the day of who? Right? Who? Is hey, vav, aleph. That's how you spell the word who. Which letters are missing? Kiyad al kes ka, right? Which letters are missing? What letters missing from kisei? Aleph. What's missing from the yud kei? Vav hey. What are the letters of the word who? Hey, vav, aleph. Hey. Vav, Aleph, right? And what's fascinating is it's backwards. We have to work our way back to there. So Bayom Hahu, on the day of who, that's when we will restore the hey, the Aleph to the Kisei, the Vav Hey to the Shem Hashem. Bayom Hahu, on that day, when we will finally fully realize how God is involved intimately in everything that goes on. There is no mikra, there is no coincidence. As Dove likes to say, coincidence is, what do you say, Dove? Ka-incidence. Yud-Hey, Hashem's name, ka-incidence. Right? There is no happenstance in the world. Once, Bayom Ahu, once we have the Vav and the Hey and the Aleph, at that day, Yeh Hashem Echad, Ushmo Echad. It'll be all one. We'll recognize there's this full, absolute, complete integration. Bimheiravi Ameinu, Amen. I agree, Dalia. Leah, and then?
Mikre, backwards, is Rak Min Hashem.
Mikre.
Mikre.
Mem Kuf Reish Hei is Rak Min Hashem. Beautiful.
What beautiful. Does it mean?
Only from both God. Ways. Mikre is coincidence, right? And mikre, right? Nice. Nice.
It's not mine. I read it somewhere.
Well, what does that mean?
I think it's not a coincidence that this...
I agree. No coincidence.
That this parak is ending with Amalek. Because the whole parak, the whole chapter is talking about the small mitzvot.
Exactly.
It's not the sacrifices and the Beit HaMikdash exactly. And the Mishkan and right. All these big things. It's the small things that allow the nation to become a nation.
Right. And to become
function,
holy.
And to function and in to everyday
be,
life.
Yeah, and to become
and
holy.
If you do not follow all those ger yatom almana, being
weights, like, being honest,
more,
right, not speaking badly.
Then it
right.
will it will weaken the
right.
nation. And because Amalek is the epitome of bad,
right.
then
exactly. Beautiful.
The nation will be
beautiful.
So weak that Amalek will come and he's a nev b'chalashim.
Right. And are not paying attention. Yavi, and are not paying attention to those small little detail things like an honest weight. And speaking about others, that is pushing God up out of this world. God cares about the high holy days. That's what he cares about. Not am I being honest when I have a business dealing with someone else. That's Amalek. He's up there. Right? And that's why those are the two coins that we started with. The two sides of this parsha. We have all of the nitty-gritty and then Amalek. And that's the two paths that we have. Beautiful.
Thank you.
Okay, we'll call it over here.
Brilliant. Who are the Amalek?
That's from the Sefer Mimam Makim. That's not my own stuff. That's for sure.
Who wrote it?
Sefer Mimam Makim.
Who wrote it?
Well, it doesn't have the name on it, but it's from Moshe Shapiro's Shiurim. They're given in Israel in Yerushalayim Thursday nights. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
He gets it from Moshe Rabbeinu.
Yeah. with a few stops along the way. I would agree with that.
Basically from God.
I wish we had a blackboard so we could write the letters.
Yeah. Sometimes that would help.
That's why it's the Torah.
Yeah.
Yeah.